Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum. I want to thank so much ICNA for inviting me to this, the 50th year anniversary. So grateful to be in front of you, so grateful to talk about this subject. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq wal afiyah and being able to truly embrace the concept that reverts matter. As our beloved moderator just mentioned, that my job is to talk about thinking globally but acting locally. So I want to talk about, when we say thinking, you know, globally while acting locally, for me it's extremely important about how I came into Islam. And so if you will allow me, I will just tell you a little bit about that story. So at the time, they had chosen about 9 students from America to represent the United States in various countries. And because I had chosen to study French and had done pretty well in my marks, I was one of those 9 who were chosen. And I was taken to Morocco. I would spend a period of time studying the culture as well as the government of Morocco. And the first night I arrived, I couldn't sleep. I was, you know, had some jet lag, and I was, you know, just about to fall asleep, that state between sleep and wakeness. And all of a sudden, the adhan went off. And when the adhan went off, the only thing I could ever compare it to is like when someone's dying on a table and there's a defibrillator. And I literally just took this deep breath as if I were breathing for the first time. And I ran to the balcony and I was trying to figure out, where is this sound coming from? And so as I begin to realize it's not just from one place, that it's actually coming in waves from one place to another, and it's growing and getting louder, I actually started to get scared. Because I said, you know, I've actually heard some things about these Arabs, and maybe this will call for war. And so I actually ran downstairs. And there was a man by the name of Ahmed, may Allah continue to bless him and ennoble his face. I said, Ahmed, what's that sound? And he said, that's the adhan, that's the call to prayer. And I said, no, I don't think so, because it's not coming from one place. Having grew up in a church community, you know, you hear the church bells coming from one place. But I said, no, this is coming in groves. It's coming, it's coming from everywhere. He said, yeah, that's the call to prayer. So I said, no, it's dark outside. It's completely black. He said, yes, that's the call to prayer. I said, okay, well, tell me what they're saying. So when he began to translate it, something inside me began to fall down. And as he began to describe that, they're just saying that Allah is the greatest. Allah is the greatest. And that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is their prophet and messenger. I immediately ran upstairs to my hotel room and I sat on the floor and I wept for about 20 minutes. And I said, wow, they're not ashamed of you. And you must know them intimately, because you taught them your name. And they say your name across the masses and across the city. So I leave Morocco, changed forever. And I arrive in Senegal. And while I'm in Senegal, it's so amazing, because now I'm not in the hotel, I'm actually with the family, and my job is to study the culture of Senegal and the Senegalese and their religion more intimately. And when I first arrive, the host of the family actually takes me door to door, neighbor to neighbor, and says, this is my sister Ieasha, who's come to visit us from America. She's returned back to us from America. And as he was looking, as he was introducing me, I was just looking at him, thinking to myself, wow, you've been taught, you're so proud of me, and I've been taught by everything in media to be so ashamed of you. So when I got back home, I couldn't, the way that I missed them was indescribable. Long story short, I had to find a masjid, had to find something about Islam, and I went and eventually converted. And that's the short version. But if you can imagine that my job, what I was sent to do, was to become a cultural ambassador. And even though they didn't recognize that when they sent me on this trip, that I would become a cultural ambassador, not just for describing what was the culture of Morocco or what was the culture that existed in Senegal of West Africa, but to describe what was the beauty of Islam. So I say that to say that many of those who are reverts will become just that. They will be the ones who will go out to the world. They will be the ones who will go out to the community, and they will become that bridge, that liaison between the Muslim community and those that we are seeking to reach. Whether we're seeking a means by which to be a means by which Allah guides them to Islam, or whether whether those reverts will simply be a means by to gain access to allies in a very authentic way. The proof of this that we find is in, of course, the example of the Sahaba of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, because we have to say, who were some of the greatest converts during the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? Majority of them were converts. But if we look at Abu Bakr Siddiq and what he was able to provide to the ummah, he was a convert. When we look at Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha and the great wisdom and inspiration that she inspires inside of us, and especially us as women, she was a convert. When we look at the courage that Omar demonstrated to defend the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and to stand up for this deen and how his heart was changed, we have to remember he was a convert. When we look at Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and we begin to recognize what wealth that he brings to our ummah, and that he was a means even of the greatness of that first hijrah that would provide protection to the Muslims because the Muslims had freed him, we have to recognize that he was a convert. So I want us to think about, how are we treating our reverts? How are we treating them when they come into our masjid? Yes, we're so excited at that, you know, that initial conversion. We're so excited about that. But I want us to think about, what do they come with? What is it that they bring to our community? So the first thing is that majority of our communities have an interfaith component. Majority of our Muslim organizations have an interfaith sector. But the reality of it is, like even myself, I am the only Muslim in my family. However, I think about what not only was I able to teach them, because for many converts, their families view them as if they have culturally betrayed their families, that they have stepped outside of their lineage, that they have joined either a cult or some type of other group. And so what becomes important is that we not only embrace them in the masjid, but that you visit them in their homes, and that while you're visiting and trying to talk about interfaith work to people that have no connection, what would be the difference if you visited the homes of those reverts who had converted to Islam, if you visit their families? Not just the ones that are in their home, but if you visited their mother, you visited their father. What then would people be able to say about Islam? That when those images are not just coming across the news, but when it's being advertised and this image of Muslims being terrorists, when that's being shown over and over by every cop show and Homeland Security and so many television programs that are reiterating this program, if we had truly visited the families of those who had reverted, they would be able to say without a shadow of a doubt, I recognize this is not the truth. Because these are people that have visited me. These are people who have spent time with me. These are people who have spent time making sure that I understood my daughter or my son's or my nephew's choice. So the first thing they bring to us is a cultural currency. They would be doing our interfaith work for us without even having to spend millions of dollars in order for that effort. The other thing they bring to us is a non-conformity. They become the ummahs. They are the defenders of the deen. Why? Because they already recognize the trials and the tribulations that are connected to not living an Islamic lifestyle. They recognize the dunya probably better than most people who are born Muslim. They recognize fully the both sides of that equation. And when they become Muslim, they say, no, without a shadow of a doubt, I'm not interested in assimilating into this culture because I know what that is. I'm not interested in conformity because I already know what that is. And they recognize Islam as something that saved their life. I recently heard Imam Zaid give a khutbah where he said very emphatically, Islam saved my life. And how many lives has Imam Zaid saved since then? How many people has he brought back to life from despair? How many people, African-American, as well as Indo-Pak, as well as Arab and Latino, not just in this country, but around the world? We would have to say the same about, they have a cultural knowledge. They know this system. And many of them are they themselves, if they're older, were involved, or their children of those who fought in the civil rights movement. And as a result of that, they understand how to stand up as leaders and how they have a spirit of resistance. They recognize what it means to fight against oppression. And many times we take that example. We take that example for them, and we find that in the Arab Spring, where what they have done locally in this country, we apply those same methods of organizing that happened right here in America. But many times we kind of appropriate this method or appropriate this teaching or appropriate this type of organizing, but we don't necessarily not only just give credit, because it's easy to give lip service, it's easy to give that kind of credit, but it's different to say, I stand with you. And I want us to understand something else that converts provide. They help us to understand the depth of the language of this country. For example, recently in the Stephon Clark passing, may Allah Ta'ala forgive him his sins and grant him Jannah to Firdaus al-Ala and take care of his children and make sure that they stay in this deen of Islam. That many of us say, I stand in solidarity with the Black Lives Matter movement, without recognizing the problems of saying, I stand in solidarity with you. To say I stand in solidarity with you means I stand beside you. What it says is I'm not you. It doesn't say that the black Muslim who was shot and killed, that I am you and you are me. So I don't stand in solidarity with you. I stand because I am you. And that's very different. And so I want to say, there inside of the convert is an inherent change, or inside the revert is an inherent change that they bring inside of us. By the nature of the different cultures and ethnicities and backgrounds and family structures that they come from, that when we truly sit and learn from them, when we truly just befriend them, when we truly embrace them, we ourselves are expanded, because we might have an eye into a culture or situations that we've only seen from a distance. We've only seen through the media. We've only seen through television. Or we've only seen through newspaper articles that we know have a slant. So when we, whether or not we are Egyptian or Palestinian, or whether or not we come from the Middle East or we come from East Africa, there are certain people that we have been taught to stay distant from. But when those reverts come into the masjid, Allah is giving you a gift for the expansion of your mind and the expansion of your soul. And when you, those who immigrated to this country, when you sit with them and allow yourself to be expanded, then you take that to your family, and they take that back to overseas. And then our perspective for how to revive Palestine is different, because you can compare the situation of having no clean water in Palestine to the situation in Flint, Michigan. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you to be able to see the struggle of a type of people because of their ethnicity, because of their background, it gives you insight for how to deal with the culture and your struggle, and why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would put you in that situation. He's demanding greatness from us. He's demanding expansion from us. He's demanding true righteousness from us. He's demanding submission from us. He's demanding that we must live up to the greatness that Islam has truly brought us. And he's demanding that we live up to the prophetic sunnah. So when we look at the likes of Imam Siraj and Imam Zaid and Dr. Sherman Jackson, and I could go on forever about the multiple converts that have been a gift for us as not just our local community, but that have been a gift for the Ummah, have been a gift for our global community. I say make sure that you are those who say, I nurtured them, not just when they walked into the doors, but I made it my business to be a part of their family and to recognize that they were me, so that when they go back, they speak the truth and they uplift this message. Jazakum Allah khairan. Assalamu alaikum.